Good morning. My name is Claire Tinker from Brown High School. My research question for this presentation today is, what is the effect of further integration of preventive care into modern healthcare to lower impact of cancer? Upon beginning my research with this paper, the first topic that came to mind was something that had been especially relevant to my family at the time, as I'm sure it is for lots of those who are in the same situation: cancer. More importantly, I wanted to answer the question, how can we keep this disease from having its lasting and negative impact on American families? I know I wasn't going to be finding a cure for cancer, but I knew there had to be some sort of preventive effort that we could take. We couldn't be entirely powerless in face of this illness. This led me to my research question. What is the effect of further integration of preventive care into modern healthcare to lower impacts of cancer? I began by checking the best place to document for genetic medicine, the encyclopedia. The Funk and Mendel's 2017 encyclopedia told me that cancer would kill 7 million people annually and was the second leading cause of death in the United States, right by heart disease. With these statistics in mind, I also began to consider how current preventive care works, how technology could be integrated into this process, how this would affect the healthcare system economically, how to make consumers practically if it was shown to have a positive impact, and an array of other factors that would go into this question. The literature review is the most effective way to see what research was already done in this field, and would allow me to find the gap in research in my field for cancer. I began by examining the state of preventive care in the United States currently. For most people, a yearly checkup with a doctor is enough to make sure that they're healthy and prevent any potential disease. However, these appointments that are meant for preventive care rarely include enough prevention. Only 10 seconds on average are dedicated to quitting smoking during regular physicals, according to an article in the Journal of Family Practice by authors Leo Duffy and Perkins, all of whom are certified family medicine physicians. Examples of preventive care, such as diet counseling and exercise regimens, can have great positive impact on the patient's life, but are minimally encouraged by physicians in a typical checkup. This demonstrates a definite immediate change in further. Another factor that the literature we established was the use of technology in preventive care. New innovations allow for closer communication between doctor and patient, and can make this care even more effective, with consistent tracking of vitals and other biometric information. Technology could also increase communication between doctor and patient, allowing for more accessibility to quality care. These factors together can increase the efficacy and ease of adding healthy habits to everyday life. Another aspect of the literature review was the economic perspective. In a closed-loop systems modeling study, authors Kumar and Nematoli concluded that preventive care is a positive investment, as it can increase productivity of the individual and decrease government or corporate spending on acute health care for said individual. This would be beneficial for Americans as a whole, not only in quality of life, but in economic terms. While the literature review was effective as establishing cancer and lack of preventive care as unrelated problems, there was minimal suggestion of solutions or preventive care's connection with cancer rates. Much of literature surrounding the topic of care for cancer discuss acute treatments for specific kinds and pointed to negative consequences overall. For example, a new experimental methodology for the purpose of treating cancer is T-cell therapy treatments, where the autoimmune system is genetically modified to be more effective against fighting malignant cells. These new treatments are limited to very specific types of cancer, such as acute lymphoblastic leukemia, and have negative after effects such as a weakened immune system. I wanted to attack this problem from a different perspective, one that asks what we can do now rather than what after being diagnosed. This research was meant to establish a connection based on medical literature already in existence to see if preventive care could be effective in lowering the prevalence of cancer. The hypothesis was that any program of preventive obesity could also be useful in preventing cancer. In order to answer the focus question, one method was utilized, traditional scholarly research. This was due to the scope of the problem and the constraints of each form of research. Scholarly research was the most effective way of gaining the most varied information from the widest range of sources in the shortest amount of time. This research was problem-oriented and was done to search for potential solutions. Due to being a student with a limited time and budget, a long-term, full-scale, independent medical study would not be feasible. Constraints of the research question also limited the methodology. For example, a survey would have done little more than provide public opinion about the topic and wouldn't lend itself sufficiently to answer the question. Ideally, the scholarly research would codify and synthesize information in order to address the specific problem. The answer to this question would have to be established through hypotheticals or the commonality of conclusions in medical research that already exists. Peer-reviewed databases such as JSTOR and KYVO were used to access this research. Keywords such as cancer treatment and preventive care were sufficient for the offered range of resources. The mentorship component was email contact with Dr. Roxanne Siegel, who works in the Department of Preventive Medicine at the Cleveland Clinic. She offered specific resources and sent me information relating to the question. Three examples of sources used were reports from the World Health Organization, copies of the Harvard Health Letter, and textbook information from the American Society of Clinical Oncology. All of these are organizations that highly expected more access to the KYBL and JSTOR. Much of the connections made were based on qualitative evidence rather than quantitative. Cancer is multifaceted disease, and factors from environments and family history can contribute to risk. Because of this, it is difficult to have direct empirical evidence and have statistics or percentages that establish these connections. The majority of sources discuss correlations and observational studies because of this issue. The results were divided into five different sections: hereditary cancer, obesity and cancer, direct obesity treatment, preventive obesity treatment, and use of technology in preventive care. Essentially, the results section categorized the different academic resources down in order to establish connections between evidence and answer the question. Preventive care and cancer discussed what is already being implemented, specifically in terms of cancer and healthcare field. For example, the Center for Disease Control and Prevention creates comprehensive cancer control plans for states or regions of the U.S., relying on the most effective preventive care methods for that area. For example, in the state of Kentucky, tobacco is popular due to its economic importance, and this makes educating teens about the connection between chewing tobacco and mouth and throat cancers more applicable to this area. The section is about acute obesity treatment and preventive obesity treatment. Both offer some specific steps that can be taken to reduce BMI and therefore lead to a healthier lifestyle, and can be effective in preventing cancer from the lead, so to be discussed between obesity and cancer. Arguably, the most important section to truly answer the question was the one about the specific relationship between obesity and cancer. This section provides the most medical evidence to support this connection. In the Journal of Nutrition, it was demonstrated that specifically colorectal cancer has higher associations with inflammatory diets, and many pro-inflammatory molecules, such as the TNFA protein, for example, are induced by obesity, and inflammation leads to increased cancer risk because the state of somatic inflammation correlates to insulin resistance, which contributes to the development of many metabolic and cardiovascular diseases, specifically hyperinsulinemia, which promotes malignant cell proliferation. These observations were supported by work published in the Journal of Internal Medicine, the American Society of Clinical Oncology textbook, and the Intestinal Risk Liver and Health and Nutrition. This chain reaction demonstrates a link between obesity and cancer, and how prevention of obesity can lower one's risk factors for developing cancer by preventing somatic inflammation. The final subheading of the results section discusses technology and preventive care, similar to the literature review, with more support for how use of technology will be a positive influence on actual implementation. For example, it discusses how quality of care can increase and how doctor-patient relations can improve through their interventions. As a connection between obesity and cancer has been established, and the efficacy of preventive care on obesity rates has shown to be significant, lifestyle changes that lower obesity rates are somewhat able to lower cancer in the United States. Therefore, referring back to the thesis, further integration of preventive care into the American healthcare system has the potential effect of lowering cancer prevalence. This addresses the gap in literature that connects preventive care and cancer treatment. This research paper synthesized academic sources from a variety of publications and authors in order to make sure that these conclusions are credible. Results previously discussed were expected due to the multifaceted nature of both diseases, cancer and obesity. A lack of direct empirical evidence makes establishing a clear connection difficult. Results stated that while there are links and potential for change, there's no guarantee for prevention due to the presence of other factors, such as predisposition or environmental influences. This is because biological mechanisms emphasizing the association between obesity and cancer are not well established. More long-term studies with sample populations would be even more effective in establishing this connection. The methodologies discussed for cancer prevention are also aligned with the preventive methods used in obesity, making an emphasis on cancer an unlikely motivator for obesity prevention. This can lessen the epidemic of American obesity, which is rampant through poor nutrition and sedentary lifestyles, afflicting over 1 in 3 of all American citizens. This is not necessarily a direct effect of increasing preventive care and education in cancer prevention. It is a helpful advantage and may cause further motivation to participate in preventive health incentives. This money saving for both patient and employer reflects earlier economic research of the closed-loop modeling system in the literature review. Regular physicals also make it easier to keep chronic diseases in check and therefore lessen their costs. There's strong possibility for improvement in American healthcare efficacy and the effect that obesity treatment costs for directed preventive care rather than drug treatment. Costs of emergency care and hospitalization would decrease solely because Americans would spend more time trying to stay healthy rather than dealing with being ill. To sum up, the ability of preventive care to improve quality of healthcare, save money in the long run, and prevent other diseases lends itself to demonstrating the importance of using this care, even in the event that cancer is not the forefront drive behind implementation. A shift from acute care to preventive care would be beneficial for the American healthcare system and could lead to better quality of life and success for American citizens. There are some limitations to my research. For example, the majority of resources written were based on observational data rather than isolated instrumentation, and therefore can only be saved as correlations rather than causation. A lack of quantitative data makes it difficult to draw definite conclusions and create the basis of hypotheticals rather than study methodology that's been put into practice. Another limitation was the fact that I only had access to high school resources and knowledge. A lack of foundational medical knowledge led to a lot of self-education on terminology, and extensive reading and text that was difficult to understand. A more complete education in this field would have made the basics of my research easier. Another disadvantage of being a student is limited access to resources. The honor was given to me by my mentor. Sources were almost entirely from online databases, and there was no way to read every single source material online in order to find the best one. The next key way to research this topic would be more expensive and time-consuming, but would also produce concrete results. A longitudinal study that sampled Americans from youth to old age and demonstrated adherence to preventive care guidelines in order to observe cancer development in an experimental setting. This would require a large and varied sample size in order to prevent outliers in addition to the known risk factors such as family history. Additionally, in regards to obesity prevention in general, I'd like to answer the research question, what is the most effective healthy habits that can prevent obesity when introduced at a young age? For example, is it more effective for schools to offer gym class or healthy school lunch options when influencing the health of their students after the school career ends? Thank you for your time. Okay, my website.
Awesome, Claire. A couple questions for you. You just kind of cycled through your sources there at the end. Of all of those sources, which would you say was the most effective in helping you answer your gap?
The most important work to answer my research was actually sent to me by my mentor. It was from an American Society of Clinical Oncology textbook. And it was instrumental in creating the medical basis that helped answer my question and provided groundwork for the rest of my research.
Awesome. And then you kind of touched on this at the end there when you addressed your limitations. What would be the one thing you would absolutely want to do if you had zero limitations? You had all the resources, all the money, all the time. What would you want to address?
If I had the medical know-how and the ability to do this, I would definitely want to study this in an actual group of people and kind of see, like, if preventive care is applied, how would cancer rates be lowered in this group versus this group that doesn't follow these instructions, and how that would work overall.
So, performing a case study almost. Awesome.